I'm Andrew Wasson from Creative Guitar Studio. Thanks for joining me for another one of my guitar lessons. This time around, we are going to do an in-depth video lesson on strumming, rhythm, and timing. This is all due to a question that was sent in from Thomas. He's out in Munich, Germany. He wrote in saying, I hope you can help. I'm pretty well a beginner level guitar player and doing not very bad overall. I am, however, having strumming problems in my rhythm playing. I understand what I want from my strumming hand, but things do not seem to be progressing well. Do you have a way to study rhythm guitar, strumming technique, and getting timing? From Thomas in Munich, Germany. Well, hey, thanks for writing in, Thomas. You know, one of the most common problems when it comes to many technical areas of playing better guitar is blaming the wrong hand for any inconsistencies. And, you know, getting better at performing rhythm guitar is certainly no different in this respect. Far too often, guitar students will blame their right hand when it's really their left hand at fault and vice versa. It's unfortunate, but it is the case. And unless a student is working very closely with a good teacher, these problems often might even go on unresolved for months or possibly even years. In this video, I'll break down how to move through a series of steps of how to gain the necessary skills for eventually becoming the best rhythm guitar player that you could possibly be. Well, when it comes to the world of strumming, rhythm, and timing, there's some important fundamentals that we want to be well aware of before we really jump headstrong into an overwhelming amount of practice into this area. Now, the first point, which is kind of going to go in hand with the second point, is, let's start here, becoming familiar with a rhythm studies chord fingering pattern first. So before you start worrying anything to do with your strum directions, what strings that you're attacking and all that stuff, you want to have a very good understanding of what's going on with the fretboard hand's layout and how it's going to grab and grip into those chord shapes, and you want to be fairly competent with them. Now, the second point here is placing your initial focus on switching the chords, not on strumming. That's really important. If you can't flip those chords one over to the next easily, you're going to have a great deal of trouble when you get into the world of trying to strum through them and create rhythmic patterns around them. Now, what I usually suggest to develop this area is to just put on a timer or a stopwatch, set it for only maybe around 1 minute, select approximately 3 to 4 chords, and see within that 1 minute time frame how many times you can loop those chords. If you can get through those chords 5 or 6 times in that 1 minute allotment, you're probably going to be doing pretty well and be ready to start getting a handle on doing some strumming concepts. If you're having a great deal of trouble flipping chords and rotating one chord to the next within that time frame, you're probably going to have to work on those shapes a little more before you can start getting into the world of strum patterns and so on. All right, let's move on. Now, the next idea, this is something people hate doing, is counting out loud. And also really paying attention to where the beats of 1 and 3 are. Those are the strong places of your measure in your typical common time of 4/4 time signature. And it's very valuable to pay attention to how things are moving and count out loud, know where your beats are, especially counting prior to playing anything. This is a really big problem I find with my own students. They just jump into an exercise, you know, they'll throw a metronome on or toss on a drum loop or something, and then they're going to try and play just out of the gate, no count in. This is really not the way to do it. Count in, just like a band would count in live on stage. Get yourself going with understanding where those beats are and where you're focused upon, and you're going to do a lot better. Let's move on now to the next one. Thinking ahead, moving chords early to arrive on each measure in time. Now, all this really comes down to is you want to be well aware of both where you're at in a chord progression and where you're headed to next. And it can get even more challenging when you'll have two chords in the same measure. So really be well aware of where you're headed next to with chord shapes and changes. And if you can keep your eyes focused ahead of where you are, if you're reading a chart, get that peripheral vision working for you and see what's coming up next. Just be well aware of what's going on
This is why prior practice of anything is really helpful. Probably the hardest thing you could do as a musician is just get thrown a chart live on stage and have to read a chart down cold. That's a very difficult thing to do. And unfortunately, that kind of thing does happen, but it's definitely not something that a beginner would be exposed to, hopefully. Anyway, let's move on here. The next one is working on finding your internal rhythm. This is really important. By turning the metronome, and this is crucial here, on and off. Now, what I mean by this is, you know, have a metronome on, listen to the beat, understand where the pulse is, and then shut it off and do some work on your chord progression. Then turn it back on, try and play along a little bit with it, then shut it off. A lot of people have an idea of a metronome workout as to turn it on and you do your best to try to play perfectly with the metronome, and you know that can lead to a lot of frustration. I wouldn't really recommend that as the best school of thought. I would rather see that metronome come on for a little while, mess around with some of the work you're doing, then shut it off, and then mess around with the metronome off, try and get used to some of the switches and changes between the chords. And I am speaking primarily for the beginners out there. I mean, an intermediate student or an advanced student certainly wouldn't have to do this. However, it's you know, when you're first getting your exposure to this stuff, this is really valuable. Have that metronome come in and out and get used to how that beat feels and internalize it. And then after, you know, you get more and more advanced with your playing, you'll be able to quickly look over a set of chord changes and turn on the metronome maybe first to a slower tempo and then work your way up to faster tempos. So remember that, you know, things change as you go through your guitar level of skill. You know, you're definitely not the same player as you move into the world of being more of an intermediate student and then moving to being an advanced player. Things expand and your ability levels obviously accelerate. So you know, pay attention to where you're at, what you need to do at the place you're at. Let's go to the next one. Working on finding your natural feel through creative rhythmic studies. Now, what I mean by this is you do not always have to follow the changes in a song with the exact rhythm groove that would be in the tune when you're, this is when you're studying it. Now, if you're playing the song live on stage, of course, you want to keep that rhythmic groove that's part of the song. But, you know, as you're practicing it, you know, change the rhythm groove around. And another thing, too, is, you know, let's say if you're working through my material for the my beginner guitar program, the introductory guitar program here at Creative Guitar, that material in a lot of the lesson plans as you go through them does not contain any kind of specific rhythm indication of what you're supposed to be doing in terms of whatever eighth note or quarter note or, you know, syncopated rhythm groove. There's generally a lot of times that, you know, sort of left up to you, and that's important because as you develop as a player, you're going to naturally start getting some of your own strum patterns, and it'll expand as you learn more songs. So, you know, if you know four or five songs, you're going to have a limited number of different kinds of rhythmic patterns that you'll have available for the strumming that you're doing. Now, as after you learn, you know, 12 or 15 or 20, 25 songs, you're going to have been exposed to great many different kinds of strum patterns, and you'll have a very expanded natural feel. So this is a really important concept to be aware of, and also an important reason why it's really vital to go and study other people's songs. You know, it's really important to do that. Well, let's go to the last point here. Slowly developing strumming patterns. And what I mean by that is strumming pattern is both a rhythmic concept, and you could have a couple eighth notes and then maybe a rest and then an eighth and then maybe a half note or a dotted quarter, or, you know, within one measure you can have a lot going on, and it can get even busier when you get into the world of triplet feels and get into you know, 16th note grooves and everything. Now, when you're working on this information, pay attention to the strum direction that you're using, because the way that you develop those strumming patterns in terms of whether it's down strums, up strums, or repetitions of multiples of any of those, it's really going to change the way the feel of the progression is coming across. And that's really great stuff too, in particular for certain styles. You know, you may be well aware that in the reggae styles, I mean, you are playing on the up, you know, in the and of one, the and of two, but the strum direction in that style of music is down. You know, it's not up, it's down on those upbeats. So this is really interesting stuff. Over time, all of this will grow on you and you'll get better and better at it. But let's move on to looking at a method that you can use on the guitar that will help you progress your level of strumming, rhythm, and timing to the next level.
Well, the first step in setting better left and right hand control is one of taking a step backward, just trying out some very simple concepts as a self-test for determining where you are and where you're going to need to get to in regard mostly to the fretboard hand and the chord shapes that you would be working on. You know, if you're working on basic open chords, that's one thing. Then when you move across the neck and you start doing bar chords and different kinds of movable shapes, that's another level of playing chords. If you decide to go into some more advanced shapes, like maybe, you know, extended chords and altered chords and, you know, those different kinds of grips that we have on the neck for those chords, they're going to take some practice and some skill development. So, you know, you want to start off though with what you can handle. You know, if you're handling the open position chords, not bad, start with those, but always be on specific chord voicings that are manageable to you. And, you know, we're going to work with sparse timing and basically focus on down strumming and just chord control, you know, fretboard hand control. So in the first example, in example one, it's really straightforward. We just have the chords of E minor, G major, and C major. And that's it. We have those three chords only. We're going to be playing them with half notes. And the idea would be to establish a feel for the count, you know, start tapping your foot, get into time, understand where that beat is, and start feeling it across each measure so that you really start internalizing your sense of timing. And, you know, you don't have to use a metronome at this point. If you wanted to turn one on for a moment just to get an accurate feel for a count, you can always turn it off and then go through the exercise. And when you feel more competent with the switches, you know, the changes from one chord to the next, you can turn it back on and then keep going with trying to develop faster tempos with it. But this is still pretty easy work. In the exercise one, we're just going to have E minor for two beats, and then we have two beats to flip our fingers into the next chord. The next one is G in the handout. Then C major, and we're going to sit on C major again for the fourth measure, and then we're just going to go through the progression again. So really, it's not a lot to do with the strum hand. It's more to do with an awareness building for what's going on with our fretboard hand. This is so important that you have good control over those chord shapes before you really get into some crazy right-hand strumming techniques. Now let's move on to example number two. The last one, you know, was obviously fairly straightforward. Hopefully both of your hands were working in concert with each other. And, you know, you want to have that decent feel with what's going on. So next up, I want to expand the timing a little in a very simple manner, though. We're just going to replace those half notes from example one with just simply quarter notes, still doing down strumming. So instead of just sustaining the chords, same chord changes, by the way, instead of just sustaining, we're going to have on every beat, we're going to have a chord strum, except for, of course, the beats of three and four, which we're still using to flip our fingers around. And this is something I really want to stress for anyone going into using new chord shapes that are unfamiliar to you, that you're still trying to get a better handle on it. It doesn't matter what they are. You know, it could be advanced jazz style chords, or, you know, whatever it may be. It could be the first times that you ever jump into the world of altered chords or whatever. You know, if you're unfamiliar with any shape, you can use this process, and it helps a lot because it's still involving timing, which is so crucial. So anyway, here's example two. Remember, it's quarter notes, down strums, and you got the two beats to flip your fingers around. That's all there is to it. So remember, you know, how you can have a metronome on and then shut it off. You can remember to tap your foot both before you play and then during, while you are running the exercise down. Remember to count. It's really good to count out loud. It's something that not enough people really work on, but count out loud is really good for you. And, you know, just really place a large focus on what's going on with your feel for this stuff. And when that's coming together, we can move on to example three. Well, our next direction is going to be getting the feel for the groove, but not really in the way that you might expect. For this exercise, I would really suggest, again, having a metronome turned on and then shutting it off and getting used to the count, having your foot tapping, count out loud, and have a lot of focus on the feel. Remember, we're after the impression of correct time, and we want that feeling for the groove to come from inside of us. We really want to internalize that. And for example three, the strum pattern is going to expand. We're going to have a strum pattern using eighth notes and a quarter note. So the pattern will be going down, up, down. It's basically, you know, very simple aspect, still using those first two beats of the measure. We're still going to have a rest on the third and fourth beats of those measures. And you just have to really take your time with it and have a really smooth attack of the down, up perspective that's happening there. In this case, again, it's down, up, down. Get your hand to feel loose and relaxed to do that strum. So, you know, another thing you could do is just, you know, don't hold the guitar pick very tightly between your fingers. Have a little bit looser grip on that guitar pick, and everything go quite well for you. Now, I'm still using the same chords in example three. I'm still going on an E minor, and then we're having a couple beats to flip our fingers. The next chord is G. A couple beats to flip fingers to C chord. And then another C chord at that fourth measure. And then just to go in the loop with those chords. So again, we're still giving time to flip fingers around and grab into the new chord shapes, but the new thing we're working on is getting a handle on the feeling for having a groove. Simple groove, you know, it's just eighth notes and a quarter note like that, but you know, it's still something to really start targeting your mind on so you have a good internal sense of rhythm and, you know, timing structure. Now, for example four, we're going to do something different with the strum pattern attack by placing the quarter note strum on the third beat of the measure. So once again, you know, you can do that idea of turning on a metronome, becoming used to the feel of time, and then turning it off, and you know, place through the study, you know, using just your tapping of your foot, and you know, counting out loud, and you know, huge focus on feel and so forth, like we've been talking. Now, in this study, we're still going to have the same concept almost that we were doing before with the down, up, and then the only thing is we're going to wait over the beat of two, and then on the beat of three is where we have another, you know, down strum. So in this case, it's a little more challenging if you're still getting used to a lot of basic chords. You know, if you hopefully you kind of know E minor, G, and C major, but, you know, if those are even still challenging for you, this example four might be, you know, a little hard to work through because we only have one beat open to flip our fingers around. It's just that fourth beat that we have, so it's a little more challenging. Let me play through the study for you, just give you an idea how it goes. We've got E minor on eighth notes, starting off on eighth notes, going down, up, and then rest, down. So the count would be one and two, three, four, and then switch. One and two, three, four, one and two, three, four, and one and two, three, four, and then back to the E minor. And that's all there is to it. Well, now that we've covered what's involved with developing a strong internal feel for the beat, as well as the basic principles for alternate strumming, the next stage for us will be moving into the targeting of specific string sets. Now, this principle is extremely helpful for the strumming hand since it takes into consideration that there's a lot more to strumming technique than just, you know, hitting the strings randomly. The attacks made by the strum hand, you know, they need to be controlled. So in example five, I have attacks that target both the lower strings down below as well as upper string sets. And that's going to be a little bit more involved as we're dealing with large chords like E minor and G major, but then the influence sort of shrinks on us there when we deal with smaller inside string chords like the C major there. We don't have the all the string sets to really start focusing on so in such a large manner, and it's much more controlled strum that needs to be going on there. Now, in example five, there's a low hit that we're making as a quarter note. And then we're going to head up to some eighths and then back to a quarter. So it's going to be lower register, upper register, and then lower register. The feel will be like this. One, two, and three, four. And then we'll move to the G and do the exact same thing. One, two, and three, four. Now on the third measure for the C chord, instead of using eighth notes, I've got two quarter notes up front. One, two, and that's on the bass register a little bit more there. And then we have a half note covering everything. Three, four, and then we're back on the fourth measure to the rhythm idea that we were doing from measures one and two, where it's the bass on the beat of one is a quarter note, and then we have those eighth notes on the second beat with the half note being played on the third beat. So it's one, two, and three, four. So here's the whole idea of how the whole line goes in example five. One, two, and three, four. One, two, and three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, and three, four. And I should mention, it's really important to get the handouts for these lesson plans, because you kind of need to see the information and all the side notes that I've put together for each of these examples and how these exercises really work. There's a lot of detail in those handouts. You can get them at my blog site at andrewwasson.com. Generally, if you are a fan of these videos and you watch them when they initially come out on Fridays, the handouts themselves are they take a little more time to create, and they usually will come out by around the noon hour central time on Sunday. So keep that in mind. You know, there's a bit of effort put into all these, so take some time to get it all organized. Anyway, let's move on to example six. In example six, I want to focus more on the groove and start really getting the strumming hand moving more. I'm going to still be targeting string sets like we had done in example five, but this time, you know, it's going to be a little bit more involved. The groove is going to be more rhythmic, and it's going to be busier, so you know you want to pace out your example prior to playing it. In the case of this one here in example six, we have the down lower register downbeat hit on the beat of one, and then it's steady eighth notes after that where it's all upper register stuff. So it's one and two, and then for the third beat it's just everything. We're strumming right across the whole string sets there, so it's one and two and three, four. And then we move on to G, one and two and three, four. And then we move into C chord, one and two and three and four, and one and two and three, four. So you just have to take your time with this stuff. I mean, it takes a little bit of practice to be able to get your coordination together, and especially when you're really factoring in the timing like we've been doing. You know, we've been talking about having a metronome on, shutting it off, getting a good internal sense of the feel together, tapping your foot, counting out loud, you know, really paying attention to the feel of everything. If you do all this stuff, you are going to really develop some top-notch guitar rhythm guitar skills. But let's move on next to getting a little bit more involved to some more complex ideas. Well, now that we've had a chance to work on all the foundational strumming concepts, it's time to begin moving into more complex ideas. One of the most popular ways we experience rhythms in music is through what's known of as syncopated feel. This is when the stress and the accent of where we attack is shifted over to other areas of the overall meter. In other words, the common places where we would think to feel strong downbeats or upbeats would change in our rhythmic feel. In example 7, I have a very common yet really straightforward example of a strum pattern that applies simple syncopation. Remember to really, you know, have a good sense of the beat, tap your foot, count solid time, and really pay attention to your feel when you do these. Anyway, you know, I think after you get your strums together, it's important to keep a metronome or a drum machine on and really get used to having that beat in the background. I haven't really stressed that enough through this lesson, but it is extremely important. Now let's move on to just going through this particular groove that I have for example 7. There's a downbeat strum that we're going to attack on the beat of 1, but that first beat is going to be a dotted quarter note. So it's going to be like this, 1 and 2, and then on the upbeat of 2 we're going to strum and get that 8th note coming along with it tied to a half note. So we're just going to sustain after that across beats 3 and 4. So it's like this, 1 and 2 and 3, 4. And then you switch your chord, 1 and 2 and 3, 4. Now, it's a little bit different on measure 3. We have a couple of eighth notes there where we're doing a more rapid down-up strum. 1 and 2, and then upbeat of 2 with the eighth note tied to the half note across sustaining the beats of 3 and 4. So 1 and 2 and 3, 4. Now, something really important in there, I don't know if you caught it or not, it was the aspect of the loss of the beat of 2, and in its place, we have to produce a rest or a moment of silence. Now, to do that, you can just use the heel of your hand here, and very quickly, it can act as a mute, and you just touch it against the guitar strings, and that'll kill out the sound of the strings for a moment and produce the rest off of whatever particular beat. For us, it's the second beat. So it's 1 and 2, and then on the upbeat of 2, we need to do that up strum. So again, here it is, 1 and rest, and you can see the hand comes down, kills out the string sets. This is going to be also really important for example 8 as well. But let me just run through example 7 one more time so you can hear everything together. Here goes. Remember to count along. So 1 and 2 and 3, 4. 1 and 2 and 3, 4. 1 and 2 and 3, 4. Okay, example 8, my last example here. I have a rather challenging strum pattern that I'm not only applying a syncopation concept through, but it's going to take things a step further by adding in some 16th note rhythms to really create more challenging, you know, tests of your rhythmic feel and the ability to create more interesting groove overall. Now, as we've mentioned previously, you want to take your time understanding the beat structure, know how the attacks will occur, and the directions you'll need for your strums. And prior to taking the test runs, you know, make sure, again, you know, that you really get a handle of where the beat is. Turn on the metronome, feel the time, then turn it off for a few of the initial passes. Turn it back on when you feel ready to play along with the beat. And just focus on internalizing the feel of the rhythm. Be sure to count your time, tap your foot, get a handle on the feel for that meter, keep it at the forefront of your mind. So anyway, here's example 8. Of course, it's still the same chords we've been using all along. Now, on the first beat, we have a dotted eighth note. So that's going to sustain for 3/4 of the beat going 1E end. And then on the final 16th of that first beat, we have a quick shot as a 16th note. It's just going to come up quickly like that. So 1E end up. And then we have a rest, so we're going to go back to the idea of touching the heel of our hand on the strings quickly to mute out the sound. Now on the upbeat of 2, we're going to have another upstrum attack on an eighth note that's going to be tied across to the downbeat of 3 on another eighth note. However, the back end of 3 is going to have a couple of 16ths. So we're going to go very quickly like that. So now what's going to happen after that is also important because it ties right in. There's going to be a quarter note. So we're going to do 3 attacks very quickly to where we're going to have some sustain off that. So let me play through the first measure. It goes like this. 1E and a 2 and 3 and a 4. So if you want to, just get good at that strumming aspect first. Really get the strumming down and then start moving through the other chord changes. Like I said before, this is going to be really challenging if you're still fairly new to rhythm guitar skills. But let me play across all those chord changes of the E minor, G major, C major, and just give you an idea of how this all comes together in example 8 here. You know, our feel for strumming and our sense of timing are directly related to our technical ability with fretting each chord shape. Our first priority is going to be having an awareness for every chord pattern. We need to develop the skill for easily grabbing them on the neck. And, you know, once we can do that, it's over to the world of timing, of feeling the count and of being able to understand the beat. Now, our next levels after that are more challenging, like developing good strum patterns, targeting into exact string sets that we want, and learning advanced rhythms like syncopation. Now, of course, this all will take time, but since the guitar is primarily a rhythm instrument, having an ability for playing solid rhythm guitar is an absolute must-know and must-have skill. Anyway, that's all for now. Once again, thanks for watching. Have fun working on all this stuff. You can download the handout and MP3 jam track for this video over at my website at andrewwasson.com. You can follow me on Twitter, like me on Facebook, and subscribe to my other guitar blog YouTube channel. The links are all in the description box for you. Take care, everyone, and we'll see you next time. Bye for now. I'd like to take a moment to mention another guitar video lesson project I've started. It's a unique guitar lesson approach that I'm doing online, and it's not like anything I've done before. Best of all, it's 100% free. I've called this approach Guitar Micro Lessons, and they're a great way to learn a few new licks or riffs or chord shapes each week. Now, these guitar micro lessons are quick and easy to learn from. They're very short, with each lesson running between only a minute and a half to 2 minutes in length. They're published to YouTube from Monday to Thursday on my other Guitar Blog Update YouTube channel, and you can either subscribe to that channel to guarantee getting each new episode, or just visit the channel whenever it's convenient for you and check out the new micro lessons in the playlist on the Guitar Blog Update channel's homepage.